Okay, it's Dave here again, back at it. So we're back at the breadboard project. I have added a couple resistors and stuff over here to pull down the analog inputs, and I got a couple of little headers sticking up out of the circuit board so I can move the oscilloscope probe around. So I've got the oscilloscope channel 1 connected here to the red lead. I also have my my good old logic probe here. So yeah, it's just connected to 5 volts up here. And I've got the programmer header plugged into the header over here, and off camera here is the PICKit 2 right here. The PICKit 2, and I'm running a software version 8.92 on the MPLAB IDE. This allows me to program this CPU and debug it at the same time. So as you've seen in the first video, I have 20 megahertz coming from this crystal oscillator going into, which pin is it? Pin number 13 here. And that gives me my oscillator clock. Now you have to configure the option register, the configuration word. You have to make sure it's set to HS, which is high speed, not RC, or it won't work properly. Excuse me. So yeah. So we'll go over to the screen on the computer right now, and we'll have a look at the actual program. Okay, so this is the program. I have modified this top line here again and put timer back the way it was originally, because I'm going to change my plan. Instead of sending the pulses out this pin here, I'm probably going to do the actual programming of the speed inside the little slave unit, because they're all going to get 20 megahertz crystal coming in, so there's no sense in generating the, you know, from this 20 megahertz generating a timing signal through a timer when I can just do it with the timer on the other CPU. The reason being, you know, I had a routine that was clocking sort of like this one right here. Let me just show you, where it would clock the timing pulse on and off. Yeah, here we are. Originally, I had it like this here, where this isn't the actual one, but where it would just check the status of the pin and then toggle it either. If it was high, it would toggle it low. If it was low, it would toggle it high. Okay, so that, what it ends up doing is, it ends up dividing the frequency that you make with the timer into half. Okay, and technically that's not what I need to do to simulate the way the Mach 3 is working. The Mach 3 uses a timing pulse for the step that's anywhere from 1 to 5 microseconds wide. So what I did was, here on the timer 1 interrupt, I added that timing here. So basically, like I said, I'm going to remove this anyways, but just going to explain this to you. So each one of these NOP operations takes 200 nanoseconds. So I want a pulse of approximately 2 microseconds. So that means I need 10 of these. Okay, so originally I had 10 nopes. First I turn on the pin, wait 10 nopes, and then turn it off. Okay, but I also needed to do some maintenance here to the timer. Every time it gets an interrupt, I have to reload the value. So what I did was take out some of the nopes and just insert those instructions here so that they would actually use up some of the nope time rather than these being down after the pin was turned low again. So now this gives me a 2 microsecond pulse. It might actually be a little bit more than that, but when, at the time I originally designed or put this in here, that was actually the code that I used. So, like I said, I'm going to remove this anyway. So basically, that's what it does. It checks to see if there's a timer interrupt, because what happens every time there's an interrupt, the CPU will go to address 4 and look and see what location it needs to go to process the interrupt. Okay? So at address 04 in the CPU, sorry, in the flash memory, this is what it does for the interrupt routine. So I'm just going to quickly explain it. Basically, it turns off the global interrupt enable so that no other interrupts can come in. Okay? Then it's saving the W, certain registers, the status register, the program counter, high and low. Program counter, and the FRS register, which is a file. Anyways, can't remember what it is, but it's for like indirect addressing. So that's that. You have to save that in case somewhere in your program you're using these, like whatever the status was or whatever the FSR is. It has to be restored when you're done the interrupt. So that's what this does. It saves all these variables into a memory location that is global, meaning it doesn't matter what page of the RAM you're on, page 0, page 1, page 2, or page 3, this register, this memory will always go to the same place. So I have them here at the very, very top of that block. Okay, like I said, it's accessible in every page. So it's sort of like a common area. So now what the interrupt routine does is it comes in here and stores all that stuff away, and then because the bank register is in status, it sets bank register to 0, because that's where most of my commonly used memory variables are located. Okay, so the first thing it does, it looks at the PIR1 interrupt register and looks to see if timer 1 has an interrupt. If it doesn't, it jumps down here to the next interrupt processing thing, because if an interrupt came in, it's got to be one of the different interrupts that you have turned on. So if it's not this one, you got to jump over what you're doing here for the timer 1 interrupt. Okay, so for timer 1 interrupt, I'm turning on the timing signal, waiting a little bit, reloading the values to run that timer, and then clearing the pin, the external pin, and then clearing the interrupt for timer 1. And then, of course, it just flows on to the next one in case there was more than one interrupt that came in. All right, so like I said, if that timer 1 wasn't interrupted, it's going to jump down here to timer 0. Okay, and then it does the same thing. It checks to see if in the interrupt control register, it checks to see if there was a timer 0 interrupt. Okay, if there wasn't, then it jumps past the timer 0 interrupt routine parts and goes down here to the analog to digital converter interrupts. Okay, and it processes that if necessary. Again, it looks at PIR1 and looks to see if there is an A to D converter interrupt flag. If there isn't, it jumps to interrupt 99. Excuse me. I might have the coronavirus. So that's right here. And then what it does here, it restores all the interrupt registers and then turns back on the global interrupt register and then return from interrupt routine takes it back to wherever it is in the program. It could be anywhere when the interrupt happens. So that's how I have it servicing the interrupt. Okay, I'm using timer 2 to make a PWM signal. So this is where I'm at today. Well, I'll go on here. Okay, so in the interrupt routine, that was the timer 1. Okay, timer 0 here, what it does is it processes a number of registers in memory. One of them is millisecond delay. Now, because this interrupt is happening at 1,000 times per second, okay, that means that's a millisecond. So what happens is there is a routine called milli. Okay, I'll show you it down here, right here. Okay, milli is a subroutine that makes a certain delay. Now, it takes over. That's all it does is loop here and the interrupts happen. So if you call this routine, it just loops around here until it sees that the milliseconds has been reduced to 0. And what you do is you load, say you wanted to, you can only do 255 milliseconds at a time. So if you wanted to delay 1 second, you would have to do that 4 times. Load 250 and call this routine 4 times. Okay? Anyways, so this is processed by the interrupt, this register here, MS loop. So the way it works is whatever you call this routine with, whatever you have in the W register gets stored into MS loop. And then what it does is it loops around here waiting for the interrupt routine to make that count equal to 0. So it counts down. So it just sits here and loops and loops and loops and loops till it sees a 0, and then it returns to wherever it is. Now I'm using that right here to just delay the loop here. This is the main loop or main void or whatever you'd want to call it. So this is where you write the main part of your characteristics of your program. So we'll go back up here and look at the timer 0 interrupt. Comes on here. First thing it does, it decrements the MS loop timer, checks to see if it's equal to 0. Or sorry, it tests it first and then looks to see if it's equal to 0. If it's equal to 0, it doesn't need to do anything. If it's higher than 0, it decrements it by 1. And then we flow on to here. So it either comes down here and jumps to here, or jumps over the go to and does the actual decrement and then flows down here. Now what that does, I call it clicker and cycle. So there's two of them. There's 100 hertz. So this is going to happen 100 times per second. So you're looking for a count of 10, because 10 divided into 1,000 gives you 100. So same thing here. It increments the clicker value, looks to see if it's greater than 10. If it is, it clears the clicker value. So this is basically just a 1 to 10 counter. That's all it does. Sit here, 1 to 10, 1 to 10, 1 to 10, which gives you an interrupt of 100 hertz. Okay, so every time it rolls over, I want it to process that. So 100 times per second, it's going to come past that point, because otherwise what it's doing is it's not equal to 10. So it jumps completely around everything else in the timer 0 interrupt. So only when it rolls it over, which is 100 times a second, does it come down through here. So this is going to process the analog to digital sequence to generate interrupts. So with these CPUs, the PIC16F877 and 876 and 875 and 874, they sorry, I picked up a package from China this morning, and ever since then I've been coughing like crazy. Anyways, so this will come down through here about 100 times per second. So what I want it to do, anyways, like I was saying, there's eight 10-bit channels on these CPUs, at least the 877. The 876, I believe, has five channels. So what I want it to do is I want it to 100 times a second flow into here. So I'm using three channels on this project. So what you do is you set up the number of interrupt channels here in your boot up sequence. So right here I'm specifying that I want, there's a code you look up in the data book, and it will tell you which pins get selected when you select three of the analog channels. And I believe it's 010 is the thing. Anyways, so I gotta put this back to one here. So that's the where you set up the analog to digital converter. So like I said, I'm using three pins. So it's this one here, keys, feed rate, and PWM volts. Okay, so I'm using them to read analog voltages. So here in the interrupt routine, what I set it up to do, and this is the way you kind of have to do it. You can't just willy-nilly read one channel, then another channel, then another channel, because you have to change the multiplexer from one channel to the other. Then you got to start the conversion, and then you got to wait for the interrupt to tell you when it's finished the conversion. So in order to do that, what I do is I want to use three channels, and there's three things I need to do for each channel. So I set up this sequencer here. It's not actually done here. It's done, actually it is done in this section here. But basically it's like this here counter. It counts through cycles from 1 to 8, or 0 to 7, basically. All right, and so when it's 0, I want it to pick channel 0 of the analog to digital converter, and then jump out. Okay, and then the next time, then the cycle gets incremented. Okay, the ADC sequence gets incremented to 1. Lower down here. So the next time it comes in here, it will go here to number 2, which is this one here. The second one is 01, and basically what it's going to do is, so here we pick the channel. The reason why you do that is because there's a settling time when you move from one multiplex input channel to another multiplex input channel. So you have to wait a certain amount of time so you don't get any glitch there. From, say you're going, the first channel has got 5 volts on it, the second channel's got 0 volts on it. When you switch over real fast, you get a glitch and you get a funny reading off your A to D converter. So what I do is I sequence it like this. So the first sequence picks the channel 0. Then the second sequence turns it on, or not turns it on, but makes it start the conversion. Okay, then the third sequence, it reads in the conversion. Okay, the fourth sequence, it goes in here and it changes the channel to channel number 1. And then the next sequence, it starts the conversion of channel number 1. And then The next one reads channel 1. Then the next one changes the channel, the multiplexer channel again here. So I just do it with bits here. I'm using bit set bit clear file to pick the channel that I want. And then next sequence, it starts it. This is the part here that actually increments the sequence. So I want 9, 3 for each channel, right? So this is the part that actually increments the sequences. Okay, so in here I only have the channel select and the start. Down below in the AD, because you only get an interrupt per ADC in a different section. So I have the reading of them down below in the A to D converter, but it still uses this sequence number. Okay, hope I explained that well. So the clicker above happens 100 times a second. This is the cycler, and it happens 10 times a second. The reason why I have that there is because you need to count to 1,000, so 100 in this upper part, which your register can only count to 255, so you have to split it either way. So I do a 100 count up here, and then I do a 10 count down here. Okay? And that gives me a 1 second process right here. So, you know, because 1,000 divided by 100 is 10, divided by 10 is 1. So here's where I can process things that happen at a 1 second level. So it does pretty well the same thing all the way through here. What it's doing is it's incrementing the seconds location and then testing it to see if it's higher than 60. Okay, if it is, it clears it and then rolls down here to increment the minutes. So it does, this is the running clock here. Seconds, minutes, hours. Okay, so that's what this does. Once a second, it processes this part right here. I have a timeout timer for the keypad, which I've got this turned off right now, but basically this will process that counter, look to see if it's equal to zero, and if it's not equal to zero, it just keeps de-incrementing it every second. So what that does is if you push a button on the keypad and it goes into a different, you know, function that it's doing, and you don't do anything else, it doesn't keep it there. It sits for a certain amount of time, and then the this key timeout is what I called it. That's a memory location. It will actually run till this gets to zero, and then once it gets to zero, it'll take me back out of whatever routine I was doing on the keyboard because I didn't respond. Usually I set this for about 15 seconds, right? So after 15 seconds, it'll take you out of whatever routine you're processing, okay? And then it reloads timer zero here and clears the interrupt, and then it flows down into here. If there was no interrupt, like I said before, if there was no timer one interrupt, it jumps past all that and goes to the A to D converter routine to see if there's an interrupt there. So here, if there was an A to D converter interrupt, it would check it here. Okay, that's looking at register PIR1 at the analog to digital interrupt flag. Okay, if that's set, it'll flow down through this section here. If not, it jumps past it, like I said before, where we restore and return from interrupt. So let's look at the analog to digital conversion interrupt. Now it's going to use the sequencer, and because sequence 0 changed the channel, sequence 1 started the conversion. Alright, now sequence 2 is we need to read channel 0. So that's what it does here. It looks to see if it's the right sequence. If it isn't, it jumps down here to the next channel to check and see if it was the sequence. And if it is, here's where we process the data. So what it's doing is it's putting it into memory. So it's 12 bits. So you look at the high byte, and there's only 2 bits there that are useful, so you mask off all the rest of them here with an AND literal. Okay, and then save it to the lower location of the analog to digital channel 0 location in memory. So there'll be 16 bits in memory, but only 10 of them are actually getting, you know, used, because it's a 10-bit resolution. Okay, so it reads in the high byte, then the low byte, processes it, turns off resets the interrupt flag, and then proceeds on. Okay, so if it was sequence number 5, that means we were working on channel number 1, AN1, which would be pin 3. It does the same thing for that. It just compares the sequence to make sure it's the right one, stores the information in RAM, which in this one is analog to digital channel number 1. And again, it saves the data in memory and then jumps out. Now I could save some code here. I'll just go on here with the next one. So here's channel 3. There is no channel 2 because that's the way the configuration setting, it'll tell you what channel. So it's 3 channels, it'll tell you which ones when you're using 3. So it's AN0, AN1, and AN3 get used. So that's why there is no use of channel 2, because that's the way it's set up. So here it picks it checks to see if it's the right sequence, and because you're going 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, reset 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, these all get done at some time or another. As a matter of fact, they get done 100 times per second. So 100 times per second divided by 8 or 9 is about, you know, 10 reads every second. Okay, so that's why I put this where it is. So again, it just flows down here and then X's out. So if I wanted to, I could actually take this, because it's common to them all, I could take this and put it on the other side here like this. So now what happens is it processes this. I don't need the code in each one of these now, so I can get rid of this, because every time it jumps down here, that's what it's gonna do. And it only gets into this if there was an interrupt. Okay, so you're guaranteed that there would be an interrupt. So I just delete those two lines. It saves me, you know, a couple memory locations. So anyways, there's how the A to D gets done. And what I like to do is write it this way. So what it ends up doing is it kind of does it in the background. Okay, same thing with writing data to a display. Rather than taking up a whole bunch of time to process, you know, 40 characters or 80 characters going to a display, I process it in an interrupt interval like this, and that way the display gets updated one byte at a time. Okay, if I have to send, you know, control words to it or whatever, I do those immediately. But to actually send the data, that's what I do, as I put it into a sequencer, so that it's not taking up a whole bunch of the main loop time to update the display. And what I do is I usually keep a copy of whatever I'm going to show in the display. I keep a copy of it right here. Yeah, well, I wonder why that's there. Sometimes I don't have the proper button on or whatever, and I'm not doing a sound generator in this, so yeah, I don't need all this other stuff, but I haven't updated this. A lot of this is copied from my template. So if I had an LCD display, I would put it right, it's right here. So on the last one, I had 48 locations that I had. Why 48? 3 line by 16. So, oh, was it, must have been a 12, yeah, it was. It was a 12 character display, 2 line by 12, and I had two screens, so it would flip back and forth. So anyway, so all these things here I don't really need. I just leave them here so that I can, I can, if I have to write some code or whatever, I've already got the format there. This is like a template from the last project that I worked on. So I'm just going to de delete all those because I don't need them. And those, I put those in the third bank of the CPU because that's just the way I like to do it. And I should really put those back because I'm not sure whether I'm going to have a display on the pendant or not. So I'm just going to leave those there. Okay, so back to the interrupt. So all those interrupts are set up here in the boot up sequence. So here's where it sets the A to D. Okay, here's where it configures each port. Port A, port B, port C, port D. So a 1 is an input, a 0 is an output. So it configures all the pins here. Okay, then it clears all the memory locations. You'll see them over here. From here all the way down to here is memory that you can use. This area here, you're not allowed. Anything with an RR is restricted, so you can't change anything in those locations. So there's four banks. So this clears the first bank indirectly, meaning that it uses the FS, FRS register. I'm just going to clean this up because I really like this stuff to look presentable, you know what I mean? Anyways, so it clears all four banks of memory, fills it full of zeros. And then down here, these are the prescaler settings, the bits. So all I have to do is rem everything except for the line that I want to use. So here you'll see prescaler on timer 1 is 64. So that's what I ended up using. And then this is where it writes it to the proper register to make it work. Okay, here's the option register, turns on or off, the port B pull-ups, and so on and so forth. So I have the port B weak pull-ups on. I haven't done any of these settings for the timer 0, but here's where you can pick what the source is, whether it's a rising edge or falling edge. I use the falling edge. Okay, and then here's the reload value for timer 1. So that from here to there is what actually sets up timer 0. Okay, here is how we set up timer 1. And in this case, timer 1 is being used for the timing pulse, which, like I said, I'm going to remove it. So what it does here, it sets it all up and then it turns it on here. But there will be no interrupt until I turn on the interrupt. It won't service it until I actually turn on the interrupt. So timer 2 is all done here. Okay. And then the RS-232 port setup, the master serial slave port I2C module is set up here, which the RS-232 and this are turned off right now. And then here's where I enable the interrupts right here. And then I clear a bunch. And then I enable some of the peripherals here. Then I start the A to D converter version, A to D converter, which I really don't need to do, but I turn it on, start it, and then here's where I enable timer 2, which I added that in there and I don't need it there, so I'm going to remove that because it's done up above here. Right here. Whoops. Right here. So this is two ways of doing it. This is loading whatever's in timer to control, inserting a 1, and then writing it back. And the reason why I'm doing two different versions of it here is I'll show you in a minute. I'm having a problem with this, okay, and I don't understand why, but anyways, I'll show it to you in a minute. So basically, it turns on the A to D converter, turns on the global, and why is that not, that should be turned on for this to work. Maybe that's why it's not working. Anyways, and then this is the end of the bank. So this is the upper bank of flash memory. So here's where it goes back to defaults, which is where, you know, when it boots, it jumps up and processes all this up above here, and then it comes down. It does a long go to default. And what that is a place where I load certain things to get my system up to date. So right now, all I have to do is look at the pins for the machine. So I move from file to working. Port, I believe this is port D. So it just reads port D, and then it masks it. So machine ID mask. It masks out the unwanted bits and then stores it in a memory location called communication ID. Okay, so I'll just show you how that works. So up here, the lower four bits of port D are the switches that are going to tell me which one of these, which controller this machine is, which machine this controller is in. So basically it reads these two pins, and these four pins. Okay, and because these are relays, I don't want them. So those are outputs and these are inputs. So I mask it off. So right here is where I specify the word machine, right? Port D. See, machine is port D, and the machine ID mask is 0001111. So in the defaults part of the program is where I read that stuff and then I store it away in RAM. Okay, so then that's where we get in. Now it's going to actually run. So this is where the main loop is here. So in the main loop, I've got a neat little trick that I do is I use a pin that I haven't done anything with yet. In this case, it's a start pin, which is on port C, pin 1, pin 0, and basically it toggles that pin on and off. Okay, so what I can do is look at it and see with a scope, I can look at this and see how fast it's looping around in this location here, and it's looping at about 400,000 times per second. So you can get an idea of how much time you can spend in here. I can do 400,000 instructions in this looping area. So it gives you kind of an idea of how much time there is. Again, sometimes what I do is I just use, like here, I use another pin that I haven't done yet. I call it a hook. And what I do is I take this, copy it, and put it in to say an interrupt routine. So let's say you want to see how long this interrupt takes to process the interrupt, which will vary from time to time. So what you do is you put that line of code here and it turns on a pin, and then when it exits out down here at the return from interrupt, you turn it back off again. So when you look at it with the scope, you can turn around and look at it and say, okay, that interrupt took this amount of time. So you know whether you're going to exceed the, you know, if another interrupt's going to come in before you're done processing. So like I said, that because of the way it processes the interrupt here, all the interrupts, okay, as it flows down through this section here, the time will vary because it might do this interrupt, and then this, or the next time just this, or all three interrupts, or all four interrupts, whatever. so you can look at it and see how much time it's taking. So I call this a hook. And I first set the bit, and then this, somewhere else I put in, I clear the bit. So you can actually watch it, see how long something's taking, or to see if your program is functioning properly. So that brings us to the IDE, okay? The MPLAB IDE is a pretty useful tool, and as far as I know, you can't do this with an Arduino, okay? But let's say let's say we want to watch it process this channel 0 interrupt, okay? So what you can do is, that's for the actual reading of the data. Let's go back, that's the funnel, that's right. Yeah, so here, let's see, every time that it's going to get 00, let's see how it processes that. Every time there's a timer interrupt, 100 times a second, it will go through here. So let's just put a breakpoint here, okay? And then what we do is, I'm going to reset the CPU, okay? And then I'm going to build my project because I've changed a couple things. So it's going to build the project over there. It took less than a second, okay? It's already programmed the chip again, all right? And now the CPU is ready to run. So it's sitting here where it's ready to boot up. So what I'm going to do is start the program, and it's going to run around now until it gets to that interrupt or that breakpoint, which it doesn't seem to be doing here. Hold on a sec here. It's because I got that global interrupts turned off. That's why. I was troubleshooting this last night, so I got to turn this back on, or it will not respond to interrupt. So here we go. Let's build it again. Done building it. It's programming. Done programming. I don't know why I get this error, but I don't want to say don't show it to me again, because it's pertinent information. So over here are all my memory locations, right? Most of the stuff I'm doing is in this block right here. So now if I say go, it will go around to that interrupt. It better. No, it didn't. Okay. So I gotta check this. I was doing some troubleshooting last night, and I probably turned everything off. So timer 0 is up at the top here. Timer 0. So let's just see. Have we got it turned on? Timer 0 set up. No, we turn it on down here. That's right. So here, timer 0. See, it's set. What the hell? So global. That's weird. It should be flying into there and giving me an interrupt. Anyways, let's just try compiling it again. And then reset and start. Maybe the breakpoint turned off. We need to go look and see. So it could be that. Oh no, there it is. So why is it not getting into here? Let's just check and see if it's actually getting an interrupt from the A to D converter or the timer. Anyways, we'll make the breakpoint right here, and that way we can actually watch a... Let's try it. What the hell? Anyways, bad time to show you this. Let me go fix it, and I'll restart the video again. Okay, so I fixed that, and it's an issue that I really can't explain, but anyways... I'm going to tack that on here or make another video explaining that. But here we are. So there's our breakpoint. the CPU, if we click on run here, it'll run now until it gets to this part in the program, and now it's stopped. Okay, so if you look at it, it's in a timer interrupt, timer zero interrupt, and it's going to process, it's going to look and see which ADC sequence is required. So it may not be, actually I can tell which one it is, it's number two. So number two is a read, so we're just going to run it around again. So number three now. Yeah, this will be number three. So it's actually going to process this part down here. So this is how it does it. It comes in, it looks at it. Is it zero? Nope. Is it one? So you watch the green arrow here. It'll show you what it's actually doing. Nope. Is it three? Yeah, it's number three. So what we're going to do is change channels. One, two, and then jump over. Clear the interrupt, which is what it should have done here. No, that was in the other sequencer. So now watch, it will bump up, and if you look at this location right here, no, it's this one, 2-6, see, 2-6, so right here is the sequence. Now you'll watch that number, it will change. See, now it's 4, because it just got incremented here. Now it's going to test it and see if it's still within the 8, or if it's, you know, 9, 1 of 9. So, because we know it's 4, it's going to jump over the clear to reset it to 0. So now it'll go down and process something else, okay? So if we're looking at this here, now what we want to do is set the breakpoint down here where it's going to actually read an A to D channel. So we'll change the breakpoint to here. Okay, and let it run. So now it's going to come around. We look over here. No, it's cycle number 5. So we've got to let it go around again because we want to see it do number 2 here. So let it run again. 5 comes around 8, and now 2. Okay, so there we are. We're at number 2. So now it'll go through here and check to see if it's that sequence, and then process this and jump around all the rest. So I'm just going to animate it so you can watch it. You can also do that animate and just watch the code run. So you'll see it all by itself. It'll jump down. It's identified it as O2. Now it's processing the data. And then it's going to jump further down here. Okay, so there's where it did its thing. And now it's getting it ready to finish processing the interrupt, and then it'll jump back to wherever it was in the program. So you'll watch here, it'll jump. So here's where it was, see? So now it'll just loop around here, or loop around here, and loop around here, because, you know, you got to set a breakpoint on one of the interrupts to make sure, because the interrupts don't get processed, you know, every time, every loop. So anyways, so the problem I'm having is I have the PWM, that is so weird. As yesterday I had an issue with this command here. That's why I did it the manual way. This is one way of doing it, this is the quicker way of doing it. So for some reason, when I booted the computer up, this would be zero, and it would just ignore this command. So I went in and I looked at it in the listing, and it's actually 1512, this code. It was 1512. So if you look at the instruction set, bit set file, so many embedded bits there are telling it which. So in this case, it's This is the second bit, like this. Bit 2, not 0, not 1, but 2. So the code for that is correct. That's location 1-2 hex in memory and byte number or bit number 2. And for some reason, if I'll just show you here. I'm going to just ram these here and put that one back. Okay, then I got to run the code, compile the code. It's programming the chip. We get that error. Close this window. Now the chip's programmed. But that location is 1-2. That where it's writing that byte or bit, sorry. See right here. Okay, so this should change this location to 0-4. And last night it wasn't doing it. So I'm going to just put the breakpoint here, let it run, and then let it step till it hits that instruction. There, it worked. It actually changed it to 4 this time. Last night, it wouldn't do that. Now, I don't know why it's doing that randomly. It seems like whatever I concentrate on. So as you could see here before, I turn on the interrupt here, but it doesn't seem to turn it on in memory. So whatever it is it seems that I'm concentrating on to work on the program, it doesn't seem to. Anyways, it's a weird, quirky little bug. Okay, but there's a way around it. And that is that you can, once the CPU is paused over here, so I'll let it run, let it come around to that part of the program. Now, if this didn't work, I can manually go over here. This is the location, so if you watch that as we step through it, it'll change to 4. There we go. It seems like it's off by 1. It hasn't even executed this command yet, and yet it did it. So that's the one that's working today. It wasn't working yesterday. But it is today, which is really weird. Now see this location here? This is that global interrupt here, and that should read E7 when everything is turned on. So if I go down here and set the breakpoint right here and let the program run, you'll see it's 6-5. Okay? Now it'll turn on the A to D converter, make the A to D converter start, and then if you watch as it processes this, it won't actually do it. So over here, this should go to E, so the 7th bit should turn on. Let's see. See, it didn't work. Okay? So, like it was a minute or so ago, that should have changed that location to F5. So, let's move the breakpoint back to the interrupt routine, and I'll show you it's not working. Because the global interrupt enable is not on. So, see, I'll set that as the breakpoint. It will never come in. It will never come in and do an interrupt. See that? See, it just keeps running. See down here? But if I pause it and change this location here to F5, which is what it should be, and write it, and now run, you'll see it processes the interrupt. See that? So it seems like wherever the issue is that I'm having, today's issue is with location 0B hex. Yesterday it was with location 1-2 hex. So I've tried upgrading the software. If you notice it, well, you can't see it, but if you notice at the top here, it'll show the version of software I'm using. I bumped it up to 8.92 last night. Didn't make any difference. I thought maybe it was the clock, because it's running at 20 megahertz. I thought maybe the clock is right at the limit of the chip, and so it's missing the odd instruction, or the odd, yeah, it's not processing a memory location properly. Anyways, it wasn't that. I changed the crystal to 16 meg, didn't seem to help. It's crazy. So I don't understand myself why it's doing that. So yeah, I want to keep this under an hour. So basically that's the part I'm going to be working on now. Now that the 1-2 is working. It's weird though, because it's not actually doing anything on the screen, on the scope. Anyways, so that's what would happen. So I'll show you just see if this is 00, 04. Yeah, again, it's not showing it on the screen here, but I'm probably on the wrong pin. Nope, I was on the right pin. Anyways, it's doing strange things, and I don't understand why, because my code is running properly. So anyways, I'm just going to let it animate here for a minute or so, and you can watch it run through the instructions here. So as it runs through here, it's updating locations over here in memory. This is a great tool for troubleshooting. I don't think you can do that with an Arduino. I have had a few issues where I have, used the wrong macro for whatever function or memory location I'm doing, and sometimes it's hard to find those. That's why I like using my template. That will, I've already troubleshooted that template before, so see, there will be an A to D interrupt because of the fact that I've delayed the because I'm animating, it's taking a lot longer, but the A to D converter still takes the same amount of time to process. So that's what it's doing now. It processed the A to D converter for channel 3, the reading, and now it's going to return from interrupt and go back, and it'll sit there in the main loop. It'll just loop around here and loop around here and loop around here. So anyways, that's the end of this video, guys. I want to appreciate I tell you I appreciate all the comments that people leave. So if you have any comments or questions, please don't hesitate to leave them in the comments, okay? Please rate and subscribe. If you aren't already a subscriber, hit that subscribe button and hit the little bell button, and you'll get an update the next time I upload another video to the interwebs. To the YouTube channel. Okay, again, thanks for watching, guys. Stay tuned for the next one in this series. That's another thing. If you could comment and tell me whether or not you really like seeing this kind of stuff. Thanks for watching. Have a great day.